Transparency and Accountability Initiative is a bit of an odd beast. We're a donor collaborative, which is a growing phenomenon, actually. There's a number of these around different geographies and issue areas, and ours is a group of funders, four large private foundations, a Medial Network, Ford Foundation, Hewlett Foundation, and Open Society Foundations, plus DFID, who support Seeker as well from the government donor side. And all of them are intrigued and have been working for a long time around exactly this intersection of issues that the Seeker and Orange teams are bringing together today. We're really interested in how does increased access to information and transparency on the part of governments and corporations translate into greater accountability for the use of public resources and citizens feeling that their voice is heard and responded to. And all our members have invested a lot in those types of initiatives over the past decade. And we just went through a stock take ourselves and a strategy refresh. And one of the big issues we faced is, well, what really is the evidence of how much transparency is following through into accountability? And having to recognize and ask ourselves some hard questions about, have we really funded this work in a way that is giving us those data points that can give us some reassurance about the most effective and smart methods to be doing? And the whole point of the collaborative is to be smarter funders. So for us, these types of events where we bring together researchers, practitioners, government public officials, and companies is exactly the kind of sort of points for sharing of ideas and perspectives that I hope will generate some new ideas of how we can do things differently going forward. I certainly think this theme of today's first panel around citizen engagement, how you use information that's made available, and how does that actually feed back into local level response and accountability is really, if we don't get it right at that local level and that granular level, then a lot of the bigger ambitions at larger scale will falter. And we've been looking particularly at how data gets used. We push for a whole range of disclosures and probably overly invested in the supply of information without having paid enough attention to how will citizens care about that? Is that a data set that people actually resonates with the issues that they're worried about on a day-to-day basis? Will that, if it is, then how will they engage around it? What are the response mechanisms and abilities for actually actions? Because if you make information available and those channels don't exist, you can probably just build greater frustration and actually have a negative effect. So these are types of issues we're looking at. We've been big champions of sort of this open government movement that's risen over the last 5 years particularly. The Open Government Partnership now has over 70 countries as members. But again, those types of global norm-setting efforts won't be sustainable unless we can make these connections back to that local level and to things citizens actually care about and are motivated to engage. So we know open government does not equal smart government, does not equal accountable government. We need to figure out what are the other pieces of the puzzle that help get us there. And I think the participation element is the one that we haven't paid enough attention to as a group of public and private funders and want to do more. So I'm really excited about the different examples we're going to hear today. They're quite eclectic, jumping around the world. But I hope that we can be thinking about pulling out what are some of the patterns and questions, and please do be thinking about points you want to ask about. I would sort of ask that maybe not ask very granular questions about one of the particular cases, but something that might provoke a bit of a discussion. We're going to try and save some time for exactly that Q&A and interaction at the end. So I'm going to ask each of our panelists to try and limit themselves to around 10 minutes, if possible. So that we do have time, because we are running a little late. But as I say, I mean, we know that context really matters, but I hope there are pieces and patterns that we can pick out that start to get us to think about, well, what is scalable in terms of the lessons learned from these particular research projects? And we did even what accountability means is something that you have to unpack in each of these. I was involved previously in a project at the World Bank where we were trying to create a social accountability project in Mongolia, and there was no translation of the word that really was meaningful. So one of the first things we actually ended up doing was bringing together a mix of government officials and local academics and civil society representatives and coming up with a new local definition of accountability that the government then started to champion and use in all their programmatic outreach. So even the language we use really matters in some of these instances. So I'm going to stop there. I'm really excited to hear more of these particular cases. So the format is we're going to hear from each of the panelists in turn. I suggest rather than putting, like making them sit up there on display, they can actually maybe stay in their seats and see each other's presentations. And then we'll ask the panel to come up. We'll do a couple of rounds of Q&A and wrap up from there. And one last word of warning to the panel. I'm going to ask you each as a last point to say the one thing based off your research that you would like to see that you think would deliver more of this bottom-up accountability. So what would be, if you had your magic wand, what would be the one thing that you would want to put in place? But let's jump straight in, and I'm delighted that Craig is actually going to go first. So Craig McIntosh from UC San Diego, who flew up this morning. So Craig, over to you.
All right, great. Well, it's an honor to kick off the academic presentations. I want to talk about a project that we ran whose central purpose was to try to understand participation, to try to bring new technologies into a very fraught environment where you have a developing democracy, the 2014 South African presidential election, and to try to bring a whole suite of new technology tools to the table and understand how those can be used to get people to participate in the political process, to report on political activities, to engage, to talk about incidents of vote buying and corruption, to get out and vote, and also to go out and monitor the polling places at which they voted to make sure that things happened in accordance with the law. So the motivation for the project is, you know, we have lots of examples, as Temine kicked off, of ICT being used in a kind of a bottom-up way that have obviously had really transformative effects in terms of the way that democratic transitions have taken place, undemocratic transitions, how elections are fought in the modern era. But many of these are very uncontrolled, unstructured environments. And so what we wanted to do is try to bring the research lens to some of this, to bring in a platform that had systematic experimental variation to understand what can be done to get people to participate more fully. So one of the strange features of almost all of the academic platforms in this area that have tried to look at how ICT can be used to generate engagement is they typically start from samples that have been collected in a standard fashion, right? So you go out, you put boots on the ground, you have a knowable group of people, and then you initiate an ICT intervention from there. That makes a lot of sense because you know who you're dealing with, but it also obviates one of the major advantages of technology, which is the ability to reach out to people at mass scale and try to get a national level platform up and off the ground. And so what we did was, starting about 6 weeks before the South African presidential election, we put in place a fully national platform that operated across a bunch of different technology channels to try to see what are the things that need to be done in order to get this type of major large-scale platform up and off the ground. So the major questions that we have for the study: how do you recruit and engage users? Who participates, and how is this driven by the specific technology platform that is being used? What are the techniques that can be used to engage people? Free airtime, lotteries, how do these work, which are effective, and what are the dynamic effects of these? And then we, at the end of the study, tried to get people to go out and actually monitor their polling places, which is a technology that Mike Callan and others have been working with over a series of different projects. And so this is asking people to jump from a low-cost ICT form of political engagement into a high-cost real-world form of political engagement. So what happens when you ask people to jump across that line? So the platform is called VIP Voice, Voting is Power. We sent out 50 million please call me messages, which are texts that are sent to mobile phones that ask people to respond to the text and get onto a platform. As they come onto the platform, we then ask them to sign terms and conditions. They're then registered. And then there's a whole set of crowdsourced information and polling activities that we tried to do over the course of the month before the election. I think one of the things that makes this project unique is that we operated across a very broad range of channels, going all the way from simple dumb phone USSD interaction all the way through pure smartphone Twitter types of platforms. The two largest by far are dumb phones, which are mobile phone USSD, and then Mixit, which is the largest social media platform in South Africa and is run off of feature phones. So not a smartphone, but not a dumb phone. So we believe this is the largest freestanding ICT platform that has ever been built to try to engage citizens around a developing democracy. So we divided into four phases. The first phase is the recruitment. We had a set of experiments there. The second phase is the crowdsourcing phase. So we're trying to understand the demographics of the participants. We're doing real-time election polling every single day. We're trying to get people to report on election violence. Is someone trying to buy votes in your community? Phase three is trying to get people to go out and monitor their polling stations on election day. And then phase four is a GOTV experiment, a get out the vote experiment, and then having people report on the voter experience after the election. So the first piece of evidence that we have is that even using dumb phones, which are reaching the poorest populations, people simply do not respond to the cost of sending text at all. So an incentive that is based on making it free to respond versus them paying the normal texting charges has absolutely no effect on participation. A lottery incentive, in other words, join today and you have a chance of winning 50 Rand, more than doubles participation, all right? So cost is not a factor in this environment. In terms of demographics, we have a huge demographic variation across the platform. So it's not surprising that the dumb phones are majority African participants, black participants. What is somewhat more surprising is that two-thirds of the dumb phone participants are female. And that then when you move on to the social media platforms, then two-thirds of the participants are male, okay? So large variation in demographics and gender across channels. So this kind of says there isn't an effect, or there isn't a group that comes onto ICT. It's really the platform that drives participation. In terms of pre-election polling, this gives daily polling responses going all the way through. So it's a very difficult thing to do to get high-frequency polling data in a developing country, so it's a very unique data source. We, of course, do not have a representative sample, right, because you start from this convenience sample, you recruit whoever comes on. So you see that we had a little bit over-representation of ANC support and under-representation of DA support over the course of the election, but the time fluctuation is very sensible. In terms of recruiting election monitors, you know, getting people's locations over a dumb phone is an extremely challenging thing to do. So we had a address lookup system that we started with that crashed and burned and completely fell apart. So then we switched to asking people to text in their polling station ID numbers, which they have on the ballots that they get sent before the election. That system worked much better. So this is showing a map of Soweto, and then the gray shaded areas are the polling precincts in which we successfully recruited election monitors. So the really kind of shocking thing about the trajectory of participation in this study is we had about 250,000 people initiate contact with the platform. And then basically every single thing that we asked people to do triggered another 50% attrition rate. And so starting with 50,000,000 please call me messages, we end up with 134,000 answering the engagement question, 90,000 registering. We invited 42,000 people to monitor, 2,500 volunteered to actually do so, and then only 332 people out of this massive sample actually successfully went to their polling stations and entered machine-readable voting data, okay? So it's an absolutely enormous wave of attrition, and really the results of the study are mostly about this attrition. So, all right, so I think this kind of tells the majority of the story that we're trying to say here is that basically, what is ICT? ICT is a very low-cost way of participating. Within our channels, we had some incredibly low-cost, easy smartphone types of interactions, and then we had dumb phones, which is a much more cumbersome way to interact with the platform. It's more expensive, it's more difficult to see. So basically, the last stage is that you actually go volunteer to monitor. This is like a real-world political activity. So what we're seeing is that basically, you get the lower the costs of using a platform, the less intrinsically motivated the users on that platform are, and that therefore the more participation falls off when you ask them to do something that is costly. And so the platforms that were the most difficult to use in the first place had people who were the most politically engaged and had the highest fraction of people who were then willing to go out and engage in real-world political activity. So the sense is here, ICT shapes the crowd. ICT brings a completely different group of people into political participation, but they're likely to be people who have very low intrinsic value for participation in politics. The incentives work to get people to monitor. And in fact, they also work in terms of data quality. So the fraction of people entering machine-readable data went up by about a factor of four when they were incentivized to do so versus being unincentivized to do so. We also detect a kind of an interesting dynamic effect of incentives. So again, once I've incentivized you to come onto the platform, I've gotten people who are less intrinsically motivated to participate politically, and consequently, they're more responsive to incentives moving forward. So in other words, the pools that were incentivized in the first place are very responsive to subsequent incentives, whereas the pools that came on to high-cost platforms that were unincentivized in the first place don't respond very much to incentives because they're intrinsically motivated in the first place, right? So the key really here is that the technology shapes the crowd, the incentives shape the crowd, and that the more you've done to lower costs, the more you're going to have to do to continue to get people to participate. So, sorry, the text is small here, but in terms of cost effectiveness, we can. This is a bit of an unfair comparison for our study because we're basically setting up the question as if all we had wanted to do was to get election monitors. So, of course, the platform had many other objectives besides that, but it's a very simple way of conducting a costing exercise. So essentially what this does is illustrate the importance of the attrition, which is because we built $1 million nation-scale platform to end up with a small number of election monitors, it ends up being cost ineffective even relative to the cost of getting a traditional international professional election monitor to come. When you incentivize people, the increase in participation more than covers its costs, and so you then slightly beat international professional election monitoring per station. So then the good news, in a sense, is that we tried a couple of other things. For example, working with a local NGO that hired a bunch of college students, trained them how to use the platform, and then sent them out to use the platform to monitor polling stations. When we did that, that resulted in an enormous increase in the machine readability of the data. They can monitor more than one station a day, and so you now end up with a very cost-effective intervention. But the point is, it isn't cost-effective when you're interacting with normal citizens in a completely unstructured way with no training. And it is only when you bring in the training on the ground that you get both the participation and the data quality high enough that the intervention starts to become cost-effective. So the one bright point you see on the margin here is that the marginal cost of an additional statement, of an additional station, once the cost of the platform is sunk, is tiny. So this thing does scale very inexpensively on the margin, but again, then you're back to the participation question. So several conclusions from the study. So the basic point is ICT shapes the crowd. There are huge demographic differences across different technology channels. Low-cost channels generally display less political engagement. Subsidies are highly effective at getting people to participate, but then generate this dynamic effect that if you've been subsidized initially, participation will fall off unless you're subsidized subsequently as well. So basically the idea, if you think of this as a way of generating election monitoring, this is not a substitute for professional election monitoring. It may be a complement, but it's not going to be something that will substitute it. This light touch training can dramatically improve data quality. And then stepping back a bit and thinking about what does this mean in general, this is a somewhat unusual project. It's an academic project, and we were very concerned that the platform didn't turn into something that was being used to disseminate incorrect information. So we didn't build links into social media that we could have. We only broadcast back out to the users on the platform very carefully controlled types of information. So I think the interesting question moving forward is, if something like this is going to take off and generate more participation in a less academic context, you're going to have to build links into social media that allow people to really feed platform data through and kind of hardwire this into social media. You're going to need, if people are reporting on election irregularities, you want that information to go to the Electoral Commission, and that's going to generate a system that has more teeth, and that is something that is then more incentive compatible for people to participate in. And then finally, figuring out ways of making all of the crowdsourced data fully public-facing, which was something that we did only in a fairly limited way because of concerns about having incorrect data go out through the platform. So takeaway message here is that getting people to do cheap and easy things with ICT is straightforward. Having that translate into real-world political activity is substantially more challenging.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Kate Casey from Stanford Graduate School of Business. And this project is from Temina's social contract. This is really looking at the question of how can we make democracy more effective? So how can we make democracy work better to constrain the behavior of elected officials? So this is in Sierra Leone, where we face a bit of an accountability puzzle. So Sierra Leone, like many sub-Saharan African countries, transitioned to multi-party democracy relatively recently. And of course, a key motivation for this is if you give citizens direct voice, it creates stronger incentives for politicians to behave better and give citizens a direct mechanism to discipline and punish bad performers. So you vote out the bad and vote in the good. The puzzle comes in is that if you look at voting in Sierra Leone, it doesn't actually seem to be very responsive to performance. So you see the same parties, the same individuals getting elected and re-elected with very healthy vote margins in the face of persistently bad public service delivery, persistently low government performance pretty much across the board. And I just want to be clear, these are free and fair elections. They get a lot of international support. So this is not about voter fraud or voter intimidation. People are casting ballots that are counted. So the question is, where is this accountability mechanism breaking down? And why isn't democracy working better to really get high performance out of government officials? And so there's obviously a lot of factors that feed into this. The one that my research has been focused on is what is the role of information? And I mean, the premise is pretty simple. So you can't have electoral accountability if voters have no information about government, about the performance of politicians. And so why might this be so? So in a country like Sierra Leone, the reach of mass media is very limited, and it's limited by poverty. So fewer than 10% of households own a television. So if you think about televised news, it's just not relevant. Fully 70% of adults have 0 years of formal schooling, so they're illiterate, they're not going to be reading print media. You can forget about the internet. I hate to say that in Silicon Valley, but it's just not relevant, at least not yet. So what is relevant? So the radio is a great source of information. I did some research earlier that looked at the role of information in building people's political knowledge and choosing the way they vote. So in general, politics in Sierra Leone is organized around ethnicity. So there's two big ethnic groups and two big political parties, and these allegiances are very strong and date back to the period around independence. So I found that people who had access to the radio learned a lot about politicians and were more willing to vote across these sort of ethnic lines for, you know, good quality politicians. But even there, only about half of households own a radio. So then, as you would expect, when you come to election day, voters don't have very much information or knowledge about the people they're voting between. And so this project, and this is with Kelly Bidwell and Rachel Glenister, is going to focus on the 2012 parliamentary elections in Sierra Leone. So you can think about parliament there as akin to the U.S. House of Representatives here. So these are small geographic areas that send one person to represent them in the capital. And so we surveyed people basically immediately after they'd voted. And we said, you know, what are the MPs meant to be doing in office? And fully 64% of people could not name a single job responsibility. You know, legislating, writing laws, representing our interests in the national government. So they didn't have an idea of what they were meant to do. And they had really no information about how much money these politicians controlled. And so this, for purposes of today, I'm going to focus on the Constituency Facilitation Fund, because it is by far the largest pot of public money that is controlled by these MPs directly. So they have full discretionary authority at an individual level about how to spend this money, which is, you know, meant to provide public goods in constituencies. So, you know, we asked voters, this CFF, it's pretty well established. It's been going on for years. People know about it. So we said, you know, how much money does your politician get every year? And, you know, even in a really generous ballpark, only 3% of people had any idea how much money was at stake. So, I mean, now my accountability puzzle doesn't seem like much of a puzzle, because if voters don't know who their MP is, don't know what they're meant to be doing in office, and don't know how much money they control, it's really hard to imagine that their votes are going to create these strong incentives for good performance. So, I mean, this just kind of immediately confronts us with two fundamental questions. So the first is, how can you create a new source of political information in this context? So this source of information, it needs to be credible, it needs to be engaging, and it needs to be accessible to voters who are very poor, illiterate, and living in geographically remote areas. The second question is, even if you've made progress on the first and you have an exciting new source of information, how do you know whether it works? How do you know whether it's effective in changing voter behavior and in changing voter behavior in a way that triggers a response by politicians and makes politicians behave better? So I'm going to start with the first question. So in terms of this new source of information, we got really excited about this idea of political debates. So these are debates between candidates from rival parties before the election. And what I like about debates is they're just incredibly rich source of information. So you get all the hard facts, you know, what are their professional qualifications, what are their policy stances, what do they plan to do in office. But then you get all this like very nuanced information about, you know, how charismatic are they, how articulate are they persuasive, do they seem trustworthy? And this all comes across, you know, pretty immediately. So to do this, we worked with a local partner, Search for Common Ground. They're civil society, nonpartisan, very well-respected in Sierra Leone, to host these debates, to assemble candidates and host the debates. So this is a still from one of the debates, just to give you a sense of what this looks like. So the gentleman on the far side in green, he's the SLPP, that's the main opposition party. The green is their party symbol, it's the palm tree. The candidate in red is from the All People's Congress, that's the incumbent party. Again, rising sun is their symbol, hence the red cowboy outfit. And then the moderator is in glasses, so he's a very well-known radio personality in Freetown, the capital. And then the gentleman on the end in orange is a third party. And the third party is basically a splinter off that first green party. And just like as a sidebar, one of the things I love, so if you look at this picture, to me, and I don't know about you, but it seems obvious that the guy in orange is like not going to win. Like, I mean, if he gets any votes, like if his mother votes for him, it'll be a miracle if those are the other two choices. But what did the debates look like? So they were very structured. So there were a series of national policy questions. Each candidate was given equal time to respond. They were very civil. They touched on things like healthcare reform. Should we massively reform our healthcare system or not? They talked about women's empowerment. So there was a legislation for a 30% quota for women in government. So would you vote for that? Would you not? Why? And then things like, you know, what is your key priority for development? Like, are you the education guy? Are you the health guy? And then how are you going to get that done? What's your plan? How are you going to make progress? So that gives you a sense. So there's a whole bunch of these debates that our partner hosted and they videotaped. And so now the question is, how are we going to get this kind of innovative source of information to the voters? And so here what the partner did is they had a roadshow, a mobile cinema, which literally means they had a truck. They put the generator into the truck, you put the sound system in the truck, the projector in the truck, and then you drive it around to communities in the weeks leading up to the election. And when they got to the communities, they'd wait till the sun sets, and then they'd project the video physically onto the side of the polling center itself. So think in your mind, think of like a primary school or a community center. And it's a big party, you know, it's fun. They play music, everybody assembles. On average, about 200 people would show up. You know, you talk to your neighbors, and they would watch these debates. So we thought this was brilliant. This was such an innovative use. I mean, this is like low-tech tech, but it was super cool, and it was like a very large advance on the status quo of what was going on. But of course, we were not the only people that thought we had great ideas in how to improve governance. So then this comes to the second question of how do we know whether this works? How do we know if this is actually going to change behavior? And here I want to like just jump really deep into the weeds on the experimental design because it's important. But just keep in mind, it's complicated because we're trying to ask two related questions. So one, how do debates impact voters? And two, how do debates impact politicians? So we're going to randomize on two levels. So this gives you a bird's eye view of our experiment overall. But let's start at the highest level of aggregation. So here, we randomized across geographic constituencies, right? So these are like the congressional districts. So there's over 100 of these in Sierra Leone. We narrowed it down to about 28 that we thought would be pretty competitive. And then we just had a lottery. So 14, the candidates, you know, got together, had the debate, then we had the roadshow. And the other 14, it's just completely politics as usual. And then importantly, the second level of randomization is inside each of these treated or the debate constituencies. This is where we had the roadshow. And this is where we're going to get impacts on voters. So the truck went around to polling centers, and we randomly allocated which polling centers would be on its route. So we had over 200 polling centers that we tracked over this period, half of which were visited by the truck and half of which were not. So then we're going to track forward to election day And we're going to survey voters, some of whom, you know, have seen the video and some of whom haven't. And so this, on Election Day, we surveyed over 5,000 people, and we asked them about, you know, their political knowledge and how they voted. And so this is that first question: do debates impact voter behavior? And we find absolutely that they do. So first, really large gains in political knowledge. So if you come back to that constituency facilitation fund, I said only 3% of people had any idea how much money was in this. If you look in the debate communities, that increases by more than fivefold. So now on Election Day, nearly 20% of people know how much money that MP has to spend each year in office. They learn things about the qualifications of candidates. So for example, the proportion of people who could tell you which candidate was better educated increased from about a quarter to 40%. And they learned where they stood on these important policy issues, you know, healthcare, women's empowerment, which sector they want to prioritize. And importantly, the key voter outcome here is, did this knowledge change how they cast their votes? And so across all of these areas, on average, we find about a 5 percentage point increase in vote shares for the candidates who perform best during the debates. And I know you're immediately going to say, well, how do you judge who performed best? And it's tricky, but we did it in two ways. One, we just asked voters, which candidate do you think performed best during the debate? But you might think that's a little subjective. So we also assembled a panel of experts, government officials, civil society, and we had them watch all these videos and score each candidate's response to each question, and you average across multiple experts. What's interesting is the voters and the experts agreed in the great majority of these cases of who performed better. So this, I think the takeaway from this is voters respond to information, and they respond to information even by changing who they vote for. So they are willing to move towards better candidates if you give them enough information. So now, but this is not enough to close that electoral accountability loop, right? Because what we now care about, is it a big enough information shock that the politicians are going to respond with better behavior? So the first suggestion or the hint that this might be going on happened a little bit earlier in time during the campaign period. So if you come back to the campaign period, remember this truck is going around to villages. And we didn't tell the candidates where the truck was going, but, you know, it's rural Sierra Leone. So you can figure out whether there's been a big assembly of 200 people after the fact. And so what we did, we collected a lot of data on how the candidates allocated their time. And we find that candidates made more in-person visits, and they made more higher campaign expenditures in these communities that were becoming much more politically informed, which is consistent with the idea that this is making these elections more competitive. You know, it's mixing up who people are voting for, like a swing voter theory. Now it's a little bit up in the air which party is going to win, and the candidates double down with greater effort. But the most important thing is tracing the winners over time. And to say, so this is the question, so if I inform all these voters, they now know who these candidates are, what they're meant to do, how much money they have, and the winners know that the voters know this. Does that close the accountability loop? So to answer this, come back and remember, you know, at the highest level, we randomized, you know, across constituencies. So after Election Day, we have 28 winners, 14 of whom by lottery participated in this whole debates, you know, hosting and roadshow, and 14 politics as usual. So we followed those 28 MPs over their first year and a half in office and collected a lot of data on performance. And so here we find some evidence that indeed it did close the accountability loop. So I've picked two indicators here. One is pretty immediate. They made more visits home. So they made more visits back to their constituency and you know, meeting with their constituents, public meetings, you know, getting a pulse of what's going on the ground and reporting back on what they were doing. But the money shot is that we looked at this CFF. And we had the MPs itemize everything that they had spent this discretionary money on. And then we did these very intensive field audits to try to verify those expenditures. So if they said, I repaired the roof of a school, we went to the school and we spoke to the principal and we said, you know, what's the status of the roof? Was it repaired? Do you have paper documents? Who paid for it? Et cetera, et cetera. So the politics as usual MPs, we could only verify about a third of this money have actually being spent on development projects in the constituency. If you then look at the debate MP, that amount increases by 2.5 times, right? So we can verify nearly 90% of these funds of having gone to development projects. So just to wrap up, the government of Sierra Leone was excited to see these results. They're keen, the National Electoral Commission is keen to scale this up. So what we're talking to them about now is how can we spread these debates to more constituencies and reach more voters at lower costs, because that truck was innovative, but it's very expensive. So we're talking about radio. And then the related research question is, if we announce this in advance, that there's going to be this free platform for mass communication with voters, does that change who decides to run for office, right? Some people that maybe aren't in with the political elites, but maybe think if I have a direct voice to the people, I might get elected. So thank you very much.
Thanks a lot for having me today. I should say, compared to the presentation you just saw, I'm going to be the guy on the right, so keep that in mind. But I also want to acknowledge the support for this project that I'm going to present results from today from the Agricultural Technology Adoption Initiative, which is a SEGA initiative I think Gates funded at some level. So that support really made an impact here, along with support from the International Growth Center and the University of California Lab. This is joint work with Ali Hassan and Yasser Khan. So I want to start with a thought experiment. Imagine for a minute that you're a rural Pakistani farmer. You probably live on a couple of dollars a day, and you rely in a large part on your livestock for your livelihood. You have a couple of cows that are going to provide you a constant stream of milk and calves that is going to be your primary or secondary income source. And these cows themselves are going to be your primary or secondary asset, maybe only second only to the land that you own. So this is a big part of your livelihood. Now imagine you wake up one morning and your cow is in heat, right? You're not going to have a bull at home because it's not worth it to keep a bull that doesn't produce milk or calves. So you're going to rely on a government or a private agent to provide you with artificial insemination. But you have a problem. How do you choose a vet for AI? A vet that's going to both be high quality and put the right effort into task to make sure your cow has the highest likelihood of getting impregnated. If this were the US, we'd all just pull out our smartphones, go on Yelp, Angie's List, Google, name your platform, and we'd look for ratings, and we'd find the best vet in our area and contact them. This is exactly what we brought to rural Punjab, Pakistan, an information clearinghouse that crowdsourced a collection of information on performance of government veterinarians to the citizens they were providing services to, aggregated this information automatically and continuously, and then provided this information back to these same consumers. Now, the reason this picture doesn't look very pretty is because all of this was built on dumb phones. This is a population in rural Pakistan, in rural Punjab, that's mainly illiterate, and smartphone penetration is very low. So we did this all built around a call center where we had real-life agents having very short phone call conversations with farmers to collect and transmit information. So what was the motivation for this? Other than the fact that this type of technological innovation is taking off across the developing world, part of it was, or the sort of the main motivation was a basic economic motivation, which is asymmetric information. The fact that farmers don't know how much effort their government or other veterinarians are putting into their job because they can't observe it very well, they don't have the expertise, or they literally are not going to be there to see how good of a job people are doing. And this is going to lead to suboptimal outcomes. So we can think of a lot of examples across the developing world of this type of asymmetric information problem. So in the private markets, we can think of these sort of farm gate middlemen and women who exploit the fact that farmers don't know prices in the local market to capture rents when buying and selling crops. Or in the government service providers, we can think about corruption, leakage, and shirking, and sort of these outcomes that arise when folks are not being monitored. And as I just said, one solution to this is actually monitoring. It's collecting information and providing that to those who are lacking it. But monitoring can be particularly costly in developing settings. This is not just because of infrastructural costs. It's expensive to send an auditor or a monitor out to rural Punjab, but also because of political economic costs. There's going to be people that want to see the status quo stay the way that it is. So crowdsourcing can make monitoring cost effective, not only because now you don't have to send a person out to collect information, you just have to get someone to answer the phone, but also because now you can spread out the information collection across a large number of people and maybe eliminate some of the information bottlenecks that give particular players power in terms of what information makes it to whom. So this is what we did. By creating a novel information clearinghouse to monitor the performance of government veterinarians in rural Punjab, Pakistan, in the district of Saival, for those who know Punjab. What exactly did this clearinghouse do? So it started by measuring effort in an important sector, government with veterinarians. I already motivated it from the household perspective. From the provincial or the national perspective, it's an extremely important sector and growing in importance. It's about 12% of the GDP of Punjab, and it's growing in share. So it's not just important for households, it's important for growth of the country as a whole. And so we started by measuring effort of these government veterinarians through our crowdsource platform. And then we aggregate this information by asking individual farmers questions continuously and automatically to create veterinarian rankings. And then disseminate this information back to the farmers. This last step we did as a randomized controlled trial. So some farmers at random got this information, some farmers at random didn't. And so we can compare subsequent outcomes for these individuals and understand the impact of this or the value of this information that we're generating through this system. And I make the point here that we gave this information to farmers, not superiors, because a lot of the work that's been done with these types of e-monitoring types of platforms, including my own past work in Pakistan, has very much been built within the existing bureaucracy. Whereas for in this case, we were sort of taking the short route of accountability to give information directly to the consumers and the citizens in this case, rather than relying on some sort of electoral accountability mechanism. And importantly, too, using GPS, we were able to disseminate ratings of local veterinarians to farmers. So we're not going to have to give them a list of every vet in their district. We can tell them the ones that are nearby and that are potentially they could go to for their services. And what do we do when we, what do we find when we give this information out? It has a large impact on subsequent performance of vets. So farmers that have information on the ratings of their local veterinarian subsequently see a 27% increase in the likelihood that their cows become pregnant the first shot. And this is a large and meaningful increase because this means more milk sooner, more calves sooner for the sort of life cycle of that cow. Interestingly, we find that this the way that this result comes about is not from farmers switching to the better vet, which is what we expected. They actually stick with their same vet, but they just demand higher quality services from those vets. And so this is going to be, it's a tough thing to think about and unpack, and we spend a lot of time thinking about this, but the takeaway here is that we don't have any sort of negative consequences where a whole bunch of people are trying to go to one vet, and maybe that vet gets overloaded, and you could actually imagine that this could create some more problems. We didn't have anything like that, so we can sort of make some pretty simple claims about the improvements of this. It's basically vets had to put some more effort in, and there's a cost to that, but it's pretty low, and farmers saw a large increase in sort of real life economic and social outcomes because of this. So let me talk just a little bit about what information we gave out and how. So specifically, farmers that were treated with information, or farmers were treated with information on the top three veterinarians within 3 kilometers of their village in terms of just average AI success rate between cows and buffaloes, which is another important breed in this setting. For each of these veterinarians, they were given information on the average AI success rate, the average price charged by this veterinarian. So this is a setting where vets are allowed to charge a price to show up because they have to travel to farms, and the number of observations that went into these two averages. And so these are akin to the same three pieces of information you'd see in most rating platforms if you go look for a local business or service provider. And we gave this information out in a very short phone call over the phone and then sent one SMS follow-up to individuals with these same nine data points. That was it. And this is essentially all the information this platform was collecting to begin with. So we weren't collecting a ton of information because collecting information, we had to talk to people, we had to engage with people, and we wanted them to answer the phone and want to talk to us. So we kept that short, and then we kept the information provision component short as well. And at least for us, that was very effective. So I already previewed the result. Here it is in a picture. So this is just comparing the effect, the average AI success rates over time for farmers that were given this information in blue and those that weren't in red. Prior to October 2014, no one was given information. And as soon as we started giving this out, across the remainder of our project, those farmers saw higher AI success rates by a large amount. So if we take this and we put it in dollar terms, we can sort of estimate the value of an increased stream of calves to these households by sort of just assuming for the life cycle of your cow, now you're gonna get milk a little sooner and the next calf a little sooner, and that's gonna snowball the next time the cow becomes pregnant, et cetera. So it's a real value to this household. In expected income terms, it's about $32, the magnitude of our effect, because cows are quite valuable in the market in Pakistan. The cost to reaching each of these farmers was $8, including all the fixed costs of developing this system, which were essentially all of the costs. The marginal cost of each phone call was pennies. So, you know, when we think about scaling this up, costs will decrease dramatically. And we can think about scaling this not just across the livestock department and or the livestock sector in all of Pakistan, but into any other sector where people will answer the phone and give us information and listen to us when we want to give them information. Now, since sort of the theme of this and to try to help with the thinking through how this would connect to other ideas we're all thinking about in the audience, I want to talk about what I think drove our success in this setting. Why, what was particularly different or important about this? So, of course, I'm going to start with saying that we crowdsource data collection. It would be very expensive, and the cost-benefit analysis would not have been on our side if we had done this with in-person monitoring or auditors, definitely. So that's just it's a requirement for this type of impact. But there's some additional keys. One, I already belabored this, but I want to say it one more time. We kept our information collection and transmission short and simple. So I've seen a lot of people working in the space these days, and they're really excited about how much information they can collect and transmit and all of the stuff you can do. And I think there's a lot of value in that, but you can overwhelm people, especially when you're talking about rural households that have a lot on their minds. There's some good work in this area and, you know, in economics saying that these folks have a hard time just making decisions. So you imagine giving too much information could be a challenge. And we did the opposite here, and we piloted it extensively to figure that out. This also connects to some research Mike Callan and co-authors and I did previously in Pakistan, where we show that keeping the information we transmit to senior health officials within the bureaucracy in Punjab also affects how they act on that information. So kind of a similar story emerges even when looking at decision-making at a very high level within the government. Another key is that the information here was objective. What do I mean by that? Everyone kind of agrees what it means for a cow to be pregnant and what it looks like. And so you don't have people disagreeing with what the average success rate of a veterinarian is. They can all understand that. And I think that's an important idea. We were collecting subjective information. It was much less valuable in this context. So I think anytime we're thinking about trying to rate people and collect information about them, we should be thinking about how we might be able to collect some more objective measures or measures that people will trust and be able to compare across individuals. And that's tricky. This is important, too. This is a setting where vets had an incentive to care about customers. It was weak because they're probably not going to get fired from their jobs, and a large part of their salary is fixed, but they're also making a little money each time they provide AI. And so they'd rather do a better job than lose a customer, and you need that. And in a lot of settings where government employees are making nothing on the margin per transaction, maybe you need to think about building some incentives in along with an intervention like this, and we've seen that this is a way that can be impactful. And it's also important, and this touches on some of the initial comments we had, that there was a lot of room for vets to improve here. So it would have been really frustrating if we started rating vets and they didn't have the skills or the abilities to do a better job. We knew that wasn't the case, but there's a lot of settings where that might not be as clear-cut and something to think about. And lastly, we spent a lot of money, actually, the majority of the money we spent on this project was to make this last bullet point, which is to verify that all the data that came into us was sort of reported accurately and there weren't any differences in selection margins along who was treated and not, and sort of only unhappy farmers answering the phone. That would have been a problem for understanding true vet ratings. So we didn't have that in this case, and that was just a little bit of luck more than that we designed this. But I think going forward, you need to think about designing checks onto the quality of your data into any of these administrative systems, because just because people are giving you data and they're excited to give you data doesn't mean it's going to be good data, and you can make a lot of bad decisions with that. And I think there's a lot of exciting ways, thinking about machine learning, and we'll hear about that later today, to try to catch the bad data before these systems do anything with them and try to do some targeted audits. With that, I will end, and thank you.
Molly Roberts. I'm an assistant professor at UC San Diego. So thanks to Orange for having us. I didn't wear orange on purpose, but I realize it was appropriate now. So technology can be used, and we've heard just a lot of really interesting examples of how technology can be used to facilitate governance and accountability. But it can also be used to evade accountability and to deceive. So I study censorship and propaganda in China, and this may be sort of the largest selective suppression of human expression in history. So we might think about, you know, selective deletion of social media posts, of information, that this is a really large system. there are many different ways in which the Chinese government tries to control information online, including removing social media posts, creating the Great Firewall to selectively block social media things, and search filtering, so reorganizing search to put different information at the top and different information at the bottom. And this is really facilitated by technology, and it's often invisible to consumers. So this is a very large operation. We estimate there are about hundreds of thousands of sensors, government sensors. Many sensors are hired at social media firms. There's also a large internet police that sort of oversees this operation. And there are rumors of, and I'll talk about this in a little bit in a second, maybe millions of people that are hired to AstroTurf or to post things online at the direction of the government. So I'm going to talk a little bit. We've done a lot of different studies of this that have appeared in a lot of different places on both what is the content of censorship and what's the content of online propaganda. And I've also done some work on what its impact are. So I'm going to talk really about what the content and of censorship and propaganda are in China today. So most people, when they think about censorship and propaganda in China, they think, well, maybe there are two different objectives. One might be to stop criticism of the state, to stop people saying bad things about the government. The other that a lot of people cite is to stop protest events or to stop people from gathering. We know that social media facilitates online and on-the-ground action. And what we find really is that the Chinese government allows quite a bit of criticism online. They delete very little criticism online. And really, a lot of the censorship and propaganda efforts of the Chinese government is to stop protests. And if you think about this, this makes a lot of sense. There are huge costs for the government to stop criticism. So if we think about in democracies, you get a lot of feedback through elections. In authoritarian regimes like China, you have trouble collecting information about what people like and what people don't like about your government. And so having information online is really useful. And we see that the government has set up a lot of institutions to sort of listen to what people are saying about policies and about local governments so that they can improve them. On the other hand, stopping protest events, there's a huge benefit. This is probably the number one danger for authoritarian regimes is protests. And so stopping these types of protests is really beneficial. And the cost of this, you already gotten this feedback, so there's not a lot of cost. So in summary, sort of just to summarize all of our findings, basically is that censorship and online propaganda is about setting the agenda online in China. So it's about taking people away from talking about protest events and talking about other things. And it's not really about winning arguments. So a lot of people think about propaganda and censorship as, you know, making people like the government more or making people, you know, persuading the people to like the government. That's not as much of what we find. We find it's mostly to change the subject. So the first study I'll talk about is we basically collected millions of social media posts in 2011 before the Chinese government was able to censor and remove them online. And the way we did this is we downloaded the content that instead it appears online, and we went and revisited this content later to see whether it was taken down or censored. And then we had a whole bunch of like censored social media posts and non-censored social media posts, and we'd use the machine learning methods to try to figure out what are the differences between these two things. So this is one example of what you might see when you encounter censorship online in China. So this is like if you went back to a URL that used to be a blog post, but then you would find this error that says, you know, the page you requested is temporarily down. How about you go look at another page? And this one in particular is not too ambiguous because it has Jingjing, one of Chinese cartoon internet polices, in the corner. It certainly has to do with sort of internet policing. So what we found at first was that, well, something that really surprised us when we started looking at this was that both censorship and post volume are bursty. So think about social media. Everybody talks about something all the time, right? So like all of a sudden, everybody's talking about one subject. That's true in China, too. And what happens is that when everybody starts talking about this one subject and it relates to a collective action event, then the government starts censoring it. So this is just one time plot of between January and July of 2011. We are following this county. It's called Zhengcheng. And in June of 2011, there are these huge riots in Zhengcheng. This pregnant migrant worker was beaten by local police. And there are big, big, big protests. We see that, the blog posts are not censored before the June, and then all of a sudden everybody's talking about this event and a lot of these things come down. And we saw this as a pattern over and over, is that when everybody starts talking about a protest event, when a protest is going on, then the red, which is the censorship, or, you know, a lot of those posts are getting taken down. So we monitored 85 different topic areas over this time period, January to July of 2011, and we identified the real-world events associated with each of these different bursts. And what we found was that government censors all posts, regardless of whether they're supportive or critical of the state, within these volume bursts that are associated with events that had collective action potential, which are either protests on the ground or people who have organized protests in the past, so like activists, those types of things. So these are the 87 events that we found within our data set. We found that there are a lot of policy and news events. This is censorship magnitude, which is the difference between censorship within the burst versus outside of the burst. We found that a lot of policy events were not censored at all. So even very controversial policies, discussions of the one-child policy, migrant worker policies, which are really controversial in China, a lot of stuff that was really critical of the Chinese government online. But the things that were mainly censored, really, really highly censored, were things like the protests in Inner Mongolia over where these, you know, huge protests happened in 2011, the arrest of Ai Weiwei, which was also during our time period. These were things that that were mainly censored. But then after we did this study, we were a little bit worried that we were missing some things about censorship. So one of the things that we did afterwards was we decided, well, let's go and download a social media platform and try to figure out what are the mechanisms of censorship and what are the posts that we're seeing when we're studying this and what are the posts that we're missing. We found that there's like a bit of a flowchart of how posts get published online. If you look kind of at the background, you look at the back of how censorship is working on a lot of these forums. One is when somebody submits a post for posting, either it could be published immediately online, in which case it would either remain online or it would be censored later. So that was what we were studying before. Or it might not be published immediately. It might be caught in like some type of keyword and never published. And in that case, it would go to review, and either then it would be published later after it was reviewed, or it would be never see the light of day. So in our observational study, we were studying these sets of posts, which had seen the light of day at some point, but we had really missed a whole bunch of different posts that were automatically deleted, and we wouldn't have seen them in the study before. So to get around this, we conducted an experiment where we conducted sort of three rounds of experiments posting social media posts on the Chinese internet. So we selected 100 of the top social media sites in China. We created two accounts on each of these social media sites. We then wrote 1,200 unique social media posts, and we posted these online and saw if they were censored. So we'd assigned these to four treatment conditions based on what we'd saw before. So either they were about a collective action event happening at the time or about another event, policy-related event at the time. And within each of these events, we posted things that were supportive of the government and things that were critical of the government. And we based our writings based off of things that we'd had seen already online in the past. And then we recorded whether the post was published immediately or if it was held for review. And we checked to see if it was subsequently censored. What we found is that there were large, we found basically the same thing we found in the observational study, is that posts that were about collective action events were much, much more likely to be censored than posts that were not about collective action events. So when we wrote posts about Panshu protests, which were these protests where the local government had grabbed land from citizens, if we wrote about that, then that would be taken down in a much higher rate in comparison to other things we wrote about during the same time period. Similarly, when we talked about Tibetan self-immolation protests or protests in Xinjiang or anything about Ai Weiwei, these things would be censored in comparison to other things. But interestingly, there was basically no treatment effect, no difference between censorship between posts that we wrote that were supportive of the government and posts that we wrote that were against the government. And that was really interesting to us. So within each of these different topic areas, there wasn't a difference in censorship between supportive and against. So it was really that the government's trying to take away all information about protest events, regardless of whether they were supportive or against the government. Okay, so the third paper I just want to talk about briefly is this sort of what we think about as reverse censorship or astroturfing, putting things online. And this is a recent study that we conducted where we looked to see, we wanted to study, what was the Chinese government posting online. This is really hard to study. There have always been rumors of this. And we studied it by using basically leaked email archive of a local propaganda office in China. So this leaked archive was posted by a blogger online, and it contained emails where workers who were 50 Cent Party members, if you think about it, or online propaganda workers, were claiming credit for their 50 Cent posts by emailing the propaganda department and saying, I posted these online, give me credit for them. And so there are about 2,000 emails within this email archive in 2013-2014, and about half of them contained these emails where people were claiming credit for their posts. And we went through this by hand and using some automated methods, and we basically extracted about 40,000 different unique social media posts that had been posted online during this time period at the direction of the government. And so what people have always thought about the 50-cent party in China is that it's there to sort of argue and debate with government critics. So people say, okay, you know, 50-cent party are people who counter government criticism online. And a lot of people online get accused of being 50-cent party members if they say anything that's sort of mean about the government and then come back and say, well, actually, the government's really awesome. So what we found was that the 50-cent party does not argue or engage on controversial issues, but really they're using a 50-cent party post to distract or to redirect public attention. And in particular, most of the 50-cent party posts we extracted from this email archive were sort of cheerleading or saying positive things about China, not even necessarily about the government. So things like, you can do it, or, you know, like, yay China, like these types of things were mostly like a lot of what was going on within the post. But that they were focused during time periods that were really sensitive to the government, and so they were sort of distracting from other things that might have been going on. So we estimated the distribution of these posts over five different categories. The first were taunting of foreign countries and arguing praise and criticism, which was the prevailing view of what the 50-cent party was doing. And then we also estimated how many of the posts were sort of non-argumentative praise or suggestions, so just praising leaders, or factual reporting, saying like, you know, this event is going on, the government's doing it, or cheerleading, so saying these positive things about the government. And we did this not only with just the leaked 50-cent posts that I was telling you about, the 40,000, but also with posts that we guessed were 50-cent party members outside of this locality based on the patterns that we saw within the data set. We basically found that across this is across the leaked emails, but also other out-of-county predictions, so predicted accounts that we thought were 50-cent party based on the patterns we saw within the data set, we found that most of the focus of the 50-cent party was focused on cheerleading and not really taunting or arguing with critics. So just to sort of conclude, it seems like the strategy of censorship and propaganda in China is not really to engage on controversial issues. It's to allow criticism that's useful for the government and not to really argue with critics or take on critics, because that just brings more attention to that issue. Rather, it's to sort of censor real-world collective action events that are directly threaten the government and its accountability and make it be more accountable, and also to distract with cheerleading and positive valence, so just to make sort of the internet be a little bit more positive. So we usually think that autocrats sort of will want to decrease knowledge of common grievances and decrease criticism to increase the cost of coordination. But we found basically that China seems to differentiate between two different types. One is like grievances, so criticism, which is allowed, and in fact that's useful from the government perspective, but collective action, which is not allowed. In general, I think that especially with the 50-cent party, there's a lot of psychology research that shows that sort of arguments never win arguments, but distraction does, and I think that's the government seems to be using that to sort of reroute people to different types of conversations online. Thank you.
But I mean, I heard a lot four totally fascinating cases as issues around asymmetry of information, short versus long routes to accountability, citizens as the recipients of information, but also as generating information, the impacts of whether they're vested directly in the implications of that information being used, or if they're further removed, does that affect their engagement and levels of participation? And also, I think Molly's piece at the end there, this whole point around transparency might be something that groups are quite comfortable with, but it becomes much more either an asset and a point for agency when it connects to participation, or a risk when it connects to participation. And that's the real piece where we get social change. So how do we better enable that? So lots of food for thought. I'm just going to open it up. Can I ask, hopefully you have someone with a roving mic, and why don't we take two or three questions right now and just sort of say your name and organization and try and keep your questions brief, and that would be great. So who has I can see one lady already with her hand up over there. Do we have a microphone? Ah, it's up here. Yeah.
I'm Radhika Shah. I'm a co-president of a Stanford Tech Innovation Club, Stanford Angels and Entrepreneurs, and an advisor to their Sustainable Development Goals Philanthropy platform. My question is, for all the panelists or any of you, how important is the role of having very different type of standards and policy for InfoTech to play a key role in civic society, getting information, participating? How much is it technology versus needing a significant shift in policy? And for example, with the UN Sustainable, with the new Secretary General, there were questions civic society could ask, and it was a process change even more than technology that those questions were part of the selection process. How much is that of a factor? And if so, can organizations like the ITU play a role, or would it be national level, or could the UN play a role?
Great. Let's take a couple more if people... All right, who else has a... I think there's one gentleman here. Yep.
Thanks. Doug Wyatt with the Human Rights Law Network in New Delhi. Some of the presentations talked about some of the different technological platforms you're dealing with, smartphones versus dumb phones, and kind of how that impacts the kind of questions you can ask and the kind of people that you're getting in your data set. Have you thought much about the trends that you're seeing in these places and how technology is shifting, both on the handsets and what kind of social media penetration is going on, and how that might change the kind of experiments you would run in the next 5 years, or what kind of programs that you could run based on not necessarily today's technology, but what we're going to be seeing soon?
Great. And do we have one more? Yes, we have.
I want to ask Molly if she's still allowed to go to China.
Well, that's a very practical question. I like that. And so we have this one around the importance of the role of the tech versus policy changes, this piece around the trends you're seeing in terms of the use of the technology. I'm intrigued on how much you think. A lot of you talk to credibility of the information. I'm also intrigued about how much the source of the information matters. I saw a study recently about citizens more intrinsically trust satellite data more than they do other, like, because it's seen as direct from technology and impartial in ways that, you know, other data sources. So, and particularly with the whole debates we see now over fake news and credibility of facts, and like how much that came into your thinking. And why don't we try and, I don't expect you to try and answer all of them, so maybe we'll just go down the line and pick up on the question that you're most interested in and sort of do 1 minute each, and then I'm gonna come back to you just to end, like, what's the one thing with your magic wand you'd wanna do that would strengthen this bottom-up accountability? So I don't know who cares to go first. Come on.
So I've got the mic, so I'll go first. So I guess I'll answer the question about whether this should be more from the policy side or more from the sort of technology side, since I did a crowdsource type innovation. I should say, and I didn't really talk about this, that our partner in this was the government, right? So they were helping set this up and make sure government vets were engaged in this. So there was a component, even to build a crowdsource platform, that we first had to have the government on board. And I think that's gonna be common in a lot of these settings. So I think these things are complementary. I think, you know, the fact that Umar is sitting right here is a good example of that as well. So someone who's a policymaker and driving the technology side. So I actually think that's more of a strength of the type of people working in this space right now, and a lot of opportunities there.
I'll address the question about technology platforms. We've done a lot of work looking at, you know, how response rates differ and how people take in information differently. So for example, we found that you have an enormous differential response rate. If you push questions out to people via SMS, they will answer them on a dumb phone. If you ask people to navigate through a menu on a dumb phone, they will not do it, and they will only do that on a smartphone. So even though there appear to be very analogous ways of using USSD that look to be organized like a website, they don't get used that way. And it ends up meaning that the architecture that you have to engineer to get effective participation with dumb phones is very different. In terms of where things are going, I guess I have a two-part answer. So one is SMS is so cheap. And even if smartphones as hardware are start to disseminate more broadly, let's say in sub-Saharan Africa, the data charges on the margin are so high in that environment that I think many people are still going to be tempted to be using the smartphone to interact via SMS rather than going on and trying to open up a web platform with a smartphone. The second part is that, you know, Silicon Valley is spending billions every minute on innovation on smartphones. And I think that in a way, the innovation that we need to be pushing, because it isn't what is happening from the private sector, is the innovation that is working over legacy channels, because that is really the thing that is going to be pushing ICT interventions out to the very poor and very isolated parts of the developing world over the course of the next few years. So I want to put a pitch that, you know, this audience that is kind of blending private technology with public funding, that's a very appropriate thing for us to be trying to do.
Just to speak to your question about the source of information and legitimacy, I think this was really important with the debates project. There's a bunch of studies that are more of a scorecard style approach. So they take, you know, members of parliament and they compile information and then they disseminate that. Some of those work and some of those don't. And one of the things, anecdotally, there was a study that McCartan Humphreys and Jeremy Weinstein did in Uganda that didn't work. And one of the things that they said was that the politicians went around and discredited the scorecard. It's like, who put this together? I'm way better than this. Like, my attendance is twice this rate. And I think the nice thing about debates is that you can't argue with a video of your own face making promises. And so it creates this public and enduring archive, at least that, you know, you're on record saying something, and maybe you can say you changed your mind. But, you know, it's harder than just saying this is not a legitimate source of information.
Yeah, so, okay, is this on? Yep. So I can't go to China. I'm going next week, so, yeah. I'm interested in just studying censorship and propaganda. I don't have a policy agenda necessarily. So it is a really good question, and especially how research interfaces with governance, I think, is something that's a broader theme of the panel. And I think that there are questions obviously about that. So a few things on credibility. So I think that the Chinese government says that its censorship program is there to prevent rumors and misinformation, which is really interesting given our current experience here. Interestingly, because when people are aware of censorship, I do think that they believe more in misinformation and rumors. Because if you think that the information environment is being manipulated, then it, in some sense, it backfires, and you think, well, maybe that's true then, even if I don't see it a lot. So there's this interesting justification for censorship and propaganda as spreading truth, right? Political justification. But then sometimes that can create an environment where there's competitive spreading of truth and then that undermines the credibility of the entire information environment. So I think that's something I'm trying to study a lot right now, is sort of paying people to get the right answer to questions and seeing how much they learn from different types of information sources and also how much they're aware of censorship. Yeah.
So Molly, what's the one thing you'd love to see funded, or the opportunity you see out there that no one's looking at around getting to accountability or around the issues that you'd like to follow up on? Is there one thing?
I think that there's a lot of really interesting questions. So a lot of censorship in China is about taxing information, so making information more difficult to access, but not necessarily prohibiting its access. So like the Great Firewall makes it more difficult to access websites from the US, but you can download a VPN and you can get there. It just takes you a little more time and money. And data availability is actually very similar. So governments can sometimes make data very easy to access where there's no barriers to access, right? Or they can make it, you know, you have to like jump through a lot of hoops in order to get this type of information. So I think that thinking about censorship more broadly and also thinking about the actual incentives, the governance incentives for providing data and what those incentives might be, and trying to understand how data transparency varies by locality based on those incentives. I think that's something that I'm really interested in looking at in the future, and I think that's general to a lot of the different questions that are being asked here.
So I think when you look at, for me, when you look at the general election in places, and U.S. as well, where there's really deep party strongholds. I'm looking at how can you, or I'm interested in how can you get voters participating in the within-party candidate selection process? Because if whoever the party puts forward wins, then the general election is a little bit irrelevant. And so you can be like beautifully enfranchised on paper, but de facto irrelevant. So I'm trying to see, can we push more just rank-and-file party members or ordinary voters into the primary process?
You know, when we do academic studies, we have to get informed consent from our subjects. We have to tell them who we are, where is the information coming from. And in the kind of project like we ran, that creates a, just a very strange informational environment for people that they're getting messages from the University of California about. So basically, the electoral commissions in developing countries are the proper parties to be trying to kind of create this direct linkage all the way to the ground and all the way to the citizens. Mike has some really interesting work on kind of the industrial organizations of corruption and where does that happen in the electoral process. So I'd really like to see the electoral commissions get involved in taking, you know, ground truth, crowdsourced data seriously as a way of trying to understand what's going on and building a deeper link with the citizenry.
Right. I think what I'd really like to see, because I think there's a lot of exciting innovations in crowdsourcing and collecting information, using that for accountability and monitoring purposes. I think actually a little bit of slowing down and stopping to take the time. One, I already talked about this, whether data quality is good and what whether the information you're using to monitor or try to keep people accountable is actually representative or the type of information you want to be collecting. And I think even a broader point about that is, as all these people are collecting tons of information and transmitting it in many different ways to the same people or the same populations, to actually try to get some of these folks together to collaborate and think about sort of more systematically platforms or sort of ways to collect information and decide what's important, allow people to decide what's important and to get that information out there to so that it's not just overwhelming. Great.
Great. Thank you all. Those great ideas, and I hope some of us in this room can follow up on some of those. And so we're going to wrap up there. I know one of the issues was clearly technology can be used for good and evil, as came through in that. And there's going to be more on machine learning later, and I wanted to just thank Arman for reminding me I need to be careful in how I use the term AI, because it does have different context contextual meanings. And I'll bear that in mind next time out. But again, huge thanks to the panel. Please try and keep a brief 10-minute coffee break so that we can come back for the keynote speaker and look forward to talking to everybody. Thank you.